Hello, welcome to What in the World. This is a regular show where enterprise geo-Googlers tell you a little bit more about an interesting part of Enterprise Maps products. My name is Dylan Thomas. I'm a community maps manager, and with me today is Graham Merrill, who's a deployment engineer. Hi, Graham.
Hi, Dylan.
And today I think you're going to tell us some really interesting handy tips about data integration.
That's right. So a lot of people, when they go down the GIS road, generally start using Google Earth to manage their data because it's simple and it has a great interface. But one of the restrictions with Google Earth is that it uses a format called KML, which is an XML format used by Google Earth. It's a very rich format, but it generally allows users to insert unstructured data into along with their content. And the problem when you move to a system like Google Maps Engine is that you require structured data to get access to the attributes.
So you might start with something simple like an HTML table, and it looks fine on the map. But then when you're saying when you move into an enterprise system, you need structured data, that becomes a problem at that point.
That's correct. And you can actually see in the example that I've got up here, I've got some mountains from New Zealand, which is my home country. And if we click on this window, you can see we get a nice piece of some HTML that pops up.
Yeah.
But it's actually represented in the KML axis as actually HTML. It's completely unstructured.
Got it. So if we were going to look at this, I mean, you're saying it's HTML code, which is fine if you want to look at it, but it's pretty horrible if you want to try and import that into some other system.
That's right. And we can actually see in this screenshot I've got up is that we actually can see the KML, the underlying KML, and what it looks like. You can see it just looks like HTML. And so if we import that into Maps Engine, you can see all we get is a description field. We're actually not able to do anything with it. So we can't style it and filter it or anything like that. And that's obviously a problem because the whole point of having or wanting to get structured data into KML and into Maps Engine is that you want to actually be able to do that sort of filtering and styling. So one of the things you can do is to change or alter the way that you create or manage your KML. And so there's two methods for doing that. The first is to use something called extended data. And extended data drops out this description field by creating essentially a set of name value pairs that you include inside your KML.
Okay.
And then to replace that description window, you create something called a balloon style. Now the nice thing about that is you just define it once at the top of the document, and then every other piece of content gets to reuse that. So it makes it much simpler to manage in terms of changing. And we can have a quick look at some KML to show you that. Here's one showing the balloon style I just briefly mentioned, and you can see some placeholders in there with square brackets. Okay, and so that data is going to get transplanted up from our placeholder, our placemark. So you can see now we've got an extended data field, we have a data name, and you can see we have the display name and the value, and also for the height, we have the display name and the value.
Ah, so it's structured, but then the other part too is that you're only defining that display style in one place, so you're not replicating the display style for every single place mark, you're just doing it once, the balloon,
that's
I should
right.
say.
That's right. So in the what I would say is, again, the classic method, if you wanted to change the format of the table, you'd have to change every single place mark, and this one you just change it once and it will... the ripples through for every single change.
Got it.
Now, if we look at Google Earth, we can see that actually that it doesn't look any different. From a user point of view, it looks as good as it ever did. Okay.
So we're done, right? We've got structured data. So what does it look like in Maps Engine then?
Well, the problem with our fantastic structured data is it imports only as a string. So here's now the data that I've converted using extended data and imported into Maps Engine, but now it's everything has gone in as a string. So now the height field is actually a number. It's 2,797 meters or what have you. So because it's a string, we actually can't perform basic comparisons like greater than or less than. So ideally, we want to be able to import numbers as numbers and dates as dates and strings as strings. That just makes good sense. So you have to switch to an alternate style to make that happen. And that's using something called schema data. Uh-huh. And schema data inside KML allows you to type your content. And it's actually slightly simpler than using extended data. The way you do it is you still define your balloon style, but then you create something at the top. You can see it highlighted in red. We create something called a schema. And you can see now we've defined something called a mountain name of a type string, and we've defined a height of type int. And you can also see I've altered the display name slightly for mountain height. So it's actually, so to illustrate that, you can actually sort of pack any sort of data that you like in there. You can even put bold and italics and others.
Nice.
Style.
Can you store, can you do dates as well, for example? Are there other types there, or is it just numbers and strings?
There's about 8 different types you can store. So string, int, date, floats, real numbers, all sorts of things. So we'll include a URL to point you to the documentation that covers this, so you can see that, read up about the different types that are supported.
Great.
So we can also now see our place mark, and you can see we have extended data in the extended data, and now we have the schema data tags and simple data tags, and you can see it's very simple. It's just simple name, value, name, value.
Much cleaner.
Right? So it actually makes our place mark very, very simple and clean to look at.
And it all looks the same in Google Earth, right? I mean, there's no difference to the consumer.
That's right. So if you go back to Google Earth and turn this one on, you can see again, it looks exactly the same. I've changed the formatting, so I apologize, Si. But you can see again, we've got Ruapehu 2,797 meters, as it should do. If you look at the data types, there it is again, same thing. Okay, so no, it's no different to the end user. But if we go have a look now in Maps Engine, I'll just go back to my search results. We now have our content in our height correctly in as a number. So
perfect.
Now we can start to do that comparison.
Yeah, excellent. And so you're recommending the use of a library to do some of this work, right?
That's correct. So one of the things, particularly if you've got you've already got a whole bunch of KML where you've got content in the description field, you need to get that out and turn it into, say, an extended data field ready for import. You need to actually, obviously it's far simpler to do that programmatically. So we have a great tool which is written by a Googler, but it's open source, called PyKML, and it makes it very easy to read and write and alter or edit KML files. Now, one of the things you could that's nice about it is that you actually just reference the tag names. So you can see about halfway down, you can see this line that begins with 4. And what it's doing is I've said for every place mark. And then KML, you know, the XML to define a point or a line is place mark. And so I just use the word place mark to say find every place mark in my KML file.
Yeah, it's almost like you're reading KML at that point. I mean, if you insert some angle brackets, it's the same thing.
Yeah, it's almost like reading KML in Python. And then, you know, you can just open up, you just have a look at the description field, which is in Python called description. And it depends on your situation, so you can read the contents of that field, and then you just write it back using extended data. So I've said here in the line here that says fragment extended data append. So all I've done in PyKML is say create a field called extended data and append some KML to it. And if you flick back in the video and have a look at the XML or the KML for this, you'll actually see it actually matches up very simply.
Oh, excellent. So in the description field, you said this is sort of a customer case-by-case basis, right? So when you actually get the description, then obviously you might need to use another library or some special logic to take your content and turn it into the structured data you want. But at that point, you're just writing it out using PyKML.
Yeah, that's right. So, you know, how you actually crack open the description field and read your data out is going to depend entirely on how you've got it in there.
Right.
If it's some nice tabular data, it's going to be quite easy to use a simple HTML library to read that. If it's just in as bullet points or something a little bit more freeform, you're going to have a bit more of a struggle to do that. Or the alternative, of course, is if the data is stored in a database of some sort, you can actually just write some PyKML to actually create PyKML from scratch. You don't need to crack open a KML file and edit it. You just dump it out from your database using the PyKML library to create a brand new KML with all of the correct fields.
Oh, that's a really good idea, yeah. Well, Graham, I got one other question for you then. So you popped up the URL for PyKML briefly. We'll put that in the video. But is there a good source for getting some real-world examples of this in action so our customers can take a look and get a head start?
Yeah, so the PyKML website includes a lot of different examples for reading, writing, and editing KML, both simple and complex. So you can manage the very large sort of structured detail of KML if you wish. And also through the PyKML website, there's actually a mailing list as well. So if you've got any questions that aren't answered by the examples or from reading the documentation, by all means, I'm sure if you jump on the mailing list, you'll be able to get your question answered there as well.
Oh, excellent. Great. Well, Graham, thanks very much indeed. Really useful information here. And we'll make sure we include the links in the video, and we'll see you next time on What in the World.